you for a very nice introduction. And I'm very happy to give this talk here. And I also would like to thank Su Xing for invitation and hospitality. Do I need a mic?
Is it also? You need two.
Oh, two, okay.
Keep going.
Okay. So today I'm going to talk about some nonlinear wave equation, and we are interested in the behavior of solutions globally in space-time for some PDEs, which are describing nonlinear wave phenomena. So this is started as a joint work with Wilhelm Schlack in Chicago, and then Joachim Krieger later joined us. Actually, more precisely, they worked before I joined on some nonlinear wave equation, and so this is kind of mixed joint work. So the contents of my talk will be the following. First, I tell you what we are interested, that is to classify the dynamics of general solutions for some nonlinear dispersive equations. And I tell you the well-known typical behavior of solutions like this. Solutions which are very different from each other. And then the key player in our classification is a sort of stationary solution called the ground state. And then I talk very quickly about the preceding results and then give our result. Then I tell you what is the most crucial idea in our theory. That is what we call one-pass theorem. And then I talk about the threshold manifold and its role in our result. Then most of our results are restricted to some range of energy value. Energy is the total energy conserved in time. But I will tell you what we can do when the energy is not in that range. And finally, I want to tell you some open questions. So first, the summary of my talk is the following. We want to know the behavior of solutions, and we want to know all the possibility of behavior for some nonlinear PDEs of wave equation. And the characteristic of those equations are that it contains nonlinear interaction and also dispersion of the wave. Dispersion means the wave tends to spread in space and goes to infinity, thereby reducing the size of amplitude. Then we want, it is well known that in general, nonlinear wave equation can have many different types of solutions, and we want to, if possible, we want to predict which behavior appears from the initial data. So to make the idea simple, I want to concentrate some simple case. Actually, so far we can treat only some simple cases, and this is the typical example of equation. And I want to mostly concentrate on this example, that is so-called nonlinear Klein-Gordon equation, which is consists of the wave equation. So this part is the classical wave equation with the second derivative in time and space, but it has some nonlinearity on the right-hand side. And I consider mainly the physical case when space-time is 1 plus 3, but a similar thing can be done, and we have done actually for similar equations like nonlinear Schrödinger equation or nonlinear wave equation with other powers. So the upshot of our result is the following. If you consider all possible solutions for such equations, of course it's a set of infinite set of many solutions, but there is some hypersurface in this set of solutions which is called center stable manifold or center unstable manifold. And it is related to some special stationary solution, which is called the ground state. And this hypersurface somehow separate the set of solutions into two parts. And one part is when the wave spreads to the spatial infinity and decay to zero. And the other case is the wave converges to, in some sense, to this type of stationary solution, which is of course non-zero. And the other case is when the amplitude goes to infinity in finite time. And we can actually classify this type of into this type of behavior completely under some energy constraint. That is, more precisely, the energy is at most slightly bigger than the energy of this guy. And we can also give some partial classification without this condition, but in that case, it is much less clear, precise. And one of the new things in our result is that we can treat solutions which exhibit different behavior at positive time and negative time. So that means dynamics changes along the evolution of time. So before going further, maybe I want to give you some concrete question in our result, related to our result. So we are interested in the time evolution for the PDEs. So let me first go back to a very classical question for the ODE. So we are interested, so this is just a model case for the differential equation. Let's take just this equation, which is coming from the our equation in the stationary case. If you want to solve this equation, and if you solve this equation for positive real value, you can impose initial condition and try to solve. Then, in particular, if you want to find a soliton solution for our equation, you want to find a solution for this equation which decays at space infinity. And it can be done by looking for some specific parameter for which the solution decays to zero. Of course, for any A, you can solve this ODE, but there is some specific value which is discrete, and the solution decays to zero. This is the well-known method, which is called the shooting method, which is useful both theoretically and just to numerically compute the solution. So as I said, this is related to our equation as giving it the soliton or stationary solutions. Then, so this is just an example of the numerics, so it's very easy. You can find a specific, if it's not a specific value of A, the solution doesn't go to zero. It is usually going to either one or minus one, because zero is an unstable stationary point. But for some specific A, so here it is like this value, then solution converges to zero. So this finds the ground state for our PDE, and of course you can find the higher value of A. So this is the second value for which the solution going to zero, but it is it has different shape. It has 1, 0. Okay, so this is a very classical thing. In this way, you can find a ground state, which is positive stationary solution, and also an excited state, which is sign changing. Then the natural question is if we can do the same for our PDEs. So this was the example of our PDE, and it is natural to try to find some special solution for this by changing the parameter, for example, in this way. You fix some function and changing the parameter A, you look at the different behavior of solution. Then numerically, it is very easy to see that if this parameter is very big, then the solution tends to blow up. This means in finite time, the amplitude goes to infinity. And if this parameter is small, then the solution decays in time and seems to going to zero. Then the question is, what happens in the intermediate A? Can we find some threshold value A such that neither happens and something special happens. Then, so this was done, as far as I know, by Bizon in 1990. And since then, it was getting quite popular, for example, in the theory or in the study of general relativity, to find some sufficient condition or a necessary condition for the formation of a black hole. But investigating this rigorously is quite hard. But anyway, we can try to see what happens here. And then, at least numerically, you can see that in the intermediate value, there is some value, some special solution which seems to converge to the stationary solution. So I just show the example. So this green curve is the solution which I just obtained by the ODE. And then just changing A, if it is too small, it goes to zero. If it is too large, then it blows up. So you can try to find, just by bisection, the intermediate value of A. Then you can see that the solution is getting closer to this green curve. And it's already getting very close, at least in this view. So it seems as if at some point like this value for A, it is almost like ground state. And of course, this cannot be convergent at time infinity to this, especially by numerical computation, because this guy is unstable. So by numerics, it cannot really converge, but by this argument, you can see that this ground state has some special role in determining the dynamics. So above this, it seems that the solution is blowing up, and below that, the solution is going to zero. So this is, in general, what we want to prove. Actually, this is a very difficult question, and indeed, our theorem does not apply to this case. Somehow, this solution is still have too much energy compared with our result. But we can prove something similar under some energy constraint. So by the way, this type of result is classical for nonlinear parabolic equation if you consider positive solutions. But in that case, you have a comparison principle. So if you consider A as a parameter, then initially the solution is ordered in terms of A, and the order is preserved in time. So in that case, it is very natural that for bigger A, it blows up, and for smaller A, it decays, and everything is aligned by A. But for wave equation, it is oscillating in time, and also it is oscillating in space. So this type of result is much harder to prove. So let me go back to the slide. So to be precise, we consider the solutions in the energy space. Energy is just defined like this for our nonlinear Klein-Gödel equation. It is just some integral of the square of derivative, and it has some nonlinear part which is sine, which has the opposite sign. Then actually our equation, and in general many nonlinear wave equation, can be regarded as a Hamiltonian system in the infinite space like this. So Hamiltonian system on the energy space, so it is in terms of the Hilbert space, it is on the H1 cross L2 space. So if you take the linear part of the energy, it defines the norm of this Hilbert space. And at least formally, and indeed you can make it rigorous, that our equation is a Hamiltonian flow on this Hilbert space. Then we consider this as a kind of phase space by analogy to the ODE, and we want to investigate the trajectories of the solutions in this infinite dimensional space. So here I'm showing you three typical and very different behavior for our equation. So depending on the effect of nonlinearity and dispersion, the solution can behave very differently. So this is the case when the solution is blowing up in finite time. So amplitude is going to infinity. This is when nonlinearity is dominating the dynamics. And this is the case when the solution is decaying and spreading in space. So this is the case when dispersion is dominating. But in between, there is something where the nonlinearity and the dispersion is in balance. And in particular, there can be such solution which doesn't depend on time. So this is the ground state, which we already seen in the numerics. So the question is, for which initial data, which case happens? And the ground state is also a very classical thing, and in our case, it can be characterized as a minimax stationary point of the energy functional. So, and the picture is something like this. If you draw the graph of the energy in the infinite dimensional space, then it has some, the leading part or the linear part is quadratic and positive, so you have something like parabola in this way, but there is also nonlinear part which is negative, and it is eventually going down. So it you have something like a volcano shape, and then the ground state is sitting around here. So if you consider one parameter family, like lambda times phi, then you have these curves. So it's always going up and down. And you have the maximal point around here. It is like the ridge of the mountain. And the ground state is just on the bottom of the on the ridge. So this is a particular critical point given by the minimax of the functional. And so here I'm denoting the derivative with respect to this direction by k. And this will play an important role to distinguish the dynamics of the solution. And actually, I will use two different types of parameter. Since it is one infinite dimension, you can consider many different types of curves. And here, I'm taking this type of curve, and actually it's a line, and this type of curve, and correspondingly, the derivative of the energy is denoted by k0 and k2. So technically, this is a bit technical, but this functional will be used to distinguish the blow-up solution, and this functional will be used to distinguish scattering. Scattering means the solution which is decaying. And since Q is here, and there is only one direction for which along which the energy is decreasing, if you Taylor expand your equation around Q, that is just a linearized operator, it has only one direction for which the energy essentially decreases. That is in this way, and this gives an eigenfunction for the linearized operator, which I will denote by rho. Okay, so this is the setting for the stationary problem. Now I very quickly go on the history of the analysis. So this is the slide which is the same as I used in the lecture. So the analysis of this type of nonlinear wave equation started around the 60s, and already they knew that there are at least three different types of solutions. So here I'm plotting imaginary picture of the energy space. Around zero, there are solutions which exist globally in time, and they knew that the solution can blow up if the energy was negative. So this is the region where energy is negative. And there is also the ground state, which is stationary in time. But these three types of solutions are distinct away from each other in the energy sense. This was the first stage. And then using the variational property, like the minimax principle in the previous slide, Penn-Sattinger was able to classify the solution with energy less than the ground state. Then the picture became like this. So there is a region which is touching to the ground state from the inside, that is the ground global solutions. From the other side, the solutions are touching the ground state, but they are blowing up. And this can be distinguished by using this functional K. So this was K0, so but now I'm dropping the subscript 0. So when this functional is positive, it is in this region and global. If this functional is negative, then it is blow up and in this region. So they have somehow complete and very simple prediction from the initial data about the fate of the solution, at least whether it is global or not. Then there was further development concerning the long-time behavior of the global solutions. And Strauss showed that if the solution is sufficiently small, then it behaves like a linear wave equation, and the wave disperses to the space infinity. Then also near the ground state, Bates and Jones were able to construct specific solutions which makes up something like a hypersurface in the energy space. So on this hypersurface, the solution stays forever close to the ground state, and they can also construct a curve like this yellow curve on which the solution is actually converging to the ground state. And considering the negative time evolution, they can construct also solutions which are staying around the ground state at negative time. But they are just a special case, and otherwise the solution may be getting away from the ground state. Then more recently, Koenig and Merle were able to show that all global solutions here are dispersing at time infinity, so they are spreading. They are not only global, but they are spreading in space at time infinity. And Dwikert's Merle were able to extend these special solutions globally in time, and they show that this guy is blowing up and this guy is scattering. And they were also able to give complete classification under this constraint. Then finally, we were able to somehow include all cases by slightly weakening that condition. So now we allow the energy to slightly exceed the ground state. Then the region becomes like this. And both the blow-up solutions and the scattering solutions have been enlarged. And there is another new region here where solution blow up in positive time and scattering, decaying in negative time. And they are split by this hypersurface that is the center unstable manifold, and this surface is hypersurface is center stable manifold. They are the solutions which are staying close forever for the ground state. So somehow under this constraint, at least concerning the long time behavior, we are able to completely classify the solutions. Although it is not a complete prediction from the initial data because we cannot be explicit about the hypersurface. So the precise statement will look like this. First, you can distinguish the initial data according to the behavior of the solution. So S is the case when the solution scatters, spread in the space. B is the case when the solution blows up. And T is somehow intermediate when the solution is staying close to the ground state. Then the conclusion is that if you impose this energy constraint, then the solutions are split into three cases, and you can also consider the same question in the negative time direction. Then you have 3 by 3, and we say that 3 is exhausting this region, and also the 3 by 3 intersection here are all non-empty, and each of them contain infinitely many solutions. More precisely, the scattering solutions and the blow-up solutions are open in the phase space. This means that if you slightly change the initial data, the behavior is the same. If the initial solution is scattering, then the perturbed solution is also scattering. The same for the blow-up. And how about the trapping? This is the somehow intermediate of them. It is not open, but they are a hypersurface, an unbounded manifold with codimension 1. And it has two connected components. And so 2 is corresponding the two ground state. One is Q and minus Q. And moreover, this two hypersurface, T plus is for the positive time and T minus is for the negative time, they are intersecting transversely, and therefore it is codimension 2. And we can moreover show that. So this means that the solution is getting close to the ground state both at time infinity and minus infinity. But however, this condition requires that the solution to stay close to the ground state for all time. So this means that the solution is order epsilon always from the ground state. And this statement is that this set of trapping set is actually the boundary separating these two stable sets, the scattering and the blow up. And also we can prove that there is no heteroclinic type orbit. That is a solution which starts from Q and going to another solution minus Q. And even in a weaker sense, the strong convergence is very difficult, but even the weak convergence is impossible. Further, if I use the spectral property of the linearized operator, actually this property is very hard to prove, but and it's not very general, but in our case it is proved, and using the spectral property of the linearized operator, we can also prove that the solution on this manifold is actually approaching to the ground state, in the sense that the difference between the solution and the ground state is scattering, so it's going to zero in a weak sense. So the entire picture of our classification can be drawn like this. So we have two hypersurfaces, which is drawn by meshed surface. One is center stable manifold, that is the set of solutions approaching the ground state at plus infinity. The other one is that approaching at minus infinity. It is separating the region into four open sets, and one set is the scattering solutions, the other is the blow-up solutions, and the other two remaining two regions is where the solution change its dynamics, and there are some intersection here where the solution stay forever for all time close to the ground state, and the yellow curve is a special solution which is converging to the ground state either at plus infinity or minus infinity. This is just a starting, and this white region we don't know at all about the other. Well, we know something, but far from being able to classify. And then we can we can extend this result in other settings. So what I talked was precisely speaking under the radial assumption. If you consider radially symmetric solutions, then the previous statement is correct. And if you consider with solutions without radial symmetry assumption, then you need to replace this ground state by a set of solitons. So if you consider a Lorentz transform of a soliton, so originally this is a stationary solution, but if you apply the Lorentz transform, then you can create a moving soliton, so a solution with a fixed shape but moving in space. Then if you replace this by this set, then and also if you replace the energy constraint to this form, where P is the conserved momentum, then the statement is essentially the same. And we can also consider the nonlinear Schrödinger equation. In that case, we still need the radial symmetry assumption. But for this equation, this stationary point will be replaced by this set. So here we have two parameters. One is complex rotation, and the other is a scaling parameter. And the energy constraint becomes a bit more complicated. Here, M is the conserved mass. But actually, this is nothing but scaling from this type of condition. So it's not really much different. And finally, we can also consider nonlinear wave equation in this form. And the difference of this equation from the other case is that this equation is the so-called energy critical case. And in particular, for this equation, even if the energy of the linear part is bounded, the solution can develop singularity. And another difference is that the stationary solution for this equation is explicit, but it's not decaying as fast as the ground state of Q. And that's the difference. And but we have essentially the same formula as I shown before. If you replace this stationary point by this type of set. So here, in addition to the Lorentz transform, we need to also consider the scaling parameter. So this is actually 6 plus 6 plus 1, 7-dimensional set. Then we have essentially the same, but there is an important difference. An important difference is that now we have splitting center stable manifold, the surface which is separating the dynamics. In the previous case, the solution on this manifold is converging in some sense to the ground state at time infinity. That is different for this equation. Now, on this surface, there are also solutions which blow up in finite time, but in a special way, blow up which looks like this, where the scaling parameter is going to infinity. So this means the stationary solution is concentrated at one point, and the remainder will be regular.
What about the energy subcritical
energy? Energy subcritical wave equation?
Yes.
It's actually more difficult because if the power is lower than this, then it cannot be controlled by using the energy when U is spreading. So in that case, the scattering part, controlling the solution which is spreading is more difficult than this case. Therefore, actually, for the nonlinear wave equation, we can consider only this case. And if the power is lower than that, then we should expect a different behavior, dynamics.
And by the way,
yes.
For the Klein-Gordon equation,
yes.
So after you take the Lorentz transformation, mm-hmm. then the energy is invariant on the... And does the energy invariant?
Energy is not invariant by the Lorentz transform. And actually, what is invariant is coming from here. So here, E square minus P square is invariant. That's why I need to add this guy. So this condition is like E square minus P square is less than this one. Yeah. That one is invariant. Okay, other question? So this is all about solutions below the energy threshold. And for higher energy, we know much less. But we can say something. For example, we can extend our manifold to higher energy. And so this is just a construction. But we can say that for given any free solution, there is a family of, so free solution means the solution to the linear equation. There is a family of solution to the original nonlinear equation with a parameter A, such that the solution is decomposed into the ground state and the linear solution at time infinity. So this kind of solution is parameterized by real value A, real parameter A. And if you gather all such solutions, then it is still as hyperservice in our energy space. But now it is not restricted under the energy constraint. Moreover, we can say that this hypersurface contains all such solutions, meaning all solutions which are asymptotic to the ground state in a weak sense. And this manifold is not globally separating. I mean, we cannot prove that this manifold is global separation between scattering and blow up, but we can still prove that it is locally separating the dynamics. So above the manifold, if it's very close, the solution is still blowing up. And below the manifold, if it's very close, then the solution is scattering. So it's a local splitting of the dynamics. And we can also consider the intersection of the extended manifold, center stable manifold in the positive time, and the center unstable manifold of the negative time. And the intersection is also extended. And along the intersection, we still keep this previous classification. It contains 9 cases. And moreover, so the meaning of this parameter is as follows. If this parameter is very big, and if you, so this is about the dynamics at time infinity. So the question is what happens at minus infinity? And we cannot say so much, but if this parameter is big, then we can prove that the solution in the negative time disperses. And if this parameter is very negative, then the solution blows up. So we have at least in some asymptotic the solution which goes to the ground state and scattering in the negative time or blowing up in the negative time. But for higher energy, we have something different from our previous result. That is what we want to call the heteroscattering or some heteroclinic orbit, which in a weak sense. That is a solution which is connecting minus Q and Q from time infinity to the minus to minus Q. So as I said, it's impossible to have this kind of connection in the strong sense. But here the connection is weak sense, meaning that the difference to this guy is spreading in space, so going to zero in the weak topology. And this kind of solution is at least of codimension 1. There may be more than that, but probably we have at least codimension 2. Okay, so this is what we can do, and maybe I should comment. Here, the parameter is only for large value, but under this constraint, what we could prove is that if A is positive, then the negative dynamics is scattering, and if it is zero, then it is converging again to the same ground state, and if it is negative, then the blow up in the negative time. So under this constraint, this parameter is gives you complete classification, but for higher energy, it is only for asymptotic values. So this is the picture for the for this new solution, which is connecting the ground state of minus Q to the plus Q. And this is some numeric. So it starts with a fixed form, but this solution is destroyed because this is unstable. And the wave tends to spread for some time. But as if it is reflected, even though there is no reflection, it is in the whole space. But there is a special solution for which the dispersed wave comes back and then form another ground state at infinity. Of course, this kind of solution is very unstable and difficult to capture by numerics, but we can at least prove the existence. Yes.
So if the energy of the solution is very different from the energy of Q,
yes,
then what you mean with that solution is close to Q?
So if I say it's scattering to Q, then it means the difference of solution and the ground state is approximated by linear solution, and the linear solution is scattering. So it's, if you measure, for example, in LP norm, then it's going to zero. The energy is big, but some LP norm is going to zero. So let me tell you some ideas in the proof. Of course, I cannot get into the techniques, but I want to tell some ideas. So before our analysis, when the energy is below the ground state, the situation was completely clear by Penn-Sattinger or Koenig and Mell. That is, the region is split into two open sets, according to the sign of some functional, and in this region they have scattering, and in the other region they had a blow up. And the main tool in the proof was the monotonicity, of a sort of monotonicity, and it is, more precisely, it is the virial identity for the nonlinear wave equation, and it gives some monotonic behavior in each region. So in this region, this tells you the solution has to blow up, spread, and in this region the solution has to blow up. But without this constraint, if you go slightly above, then this kind of complete splitting is no longer true, and these two regions are connected above the ground state. So this type of thing doesn't happen. However, if this epsilon is very small, they are connected but still in a very small neighborhood, and it is connected only in a small neighborhood of the ground state. So in particular, if you want to go from one side to the other side, you have to go through this small neighborhood, and otherwise this kind of picture still remain correct. This functional keeps the same sign, and you have a sort of monotonicity. And then, however, there is certainly a solution which goes from one side to the other side. Then the main question is how much you have this kind of changing of behavior. Then it could be a disaster if this kind of changing phase happen many times. But what saves us is that this can happen only once in time. And therefore, once it goes, for example, from the scattering side to blow up side, then we know that this solution has to blow up and it doesn't come back. And in this way, we can somehow predict the behavior of a solution. So this was the key idea. And for the construction of manifold, the manifold that is hypersurface separating the dynamics, it is somehow a classical idea, and we just need to implement in the nonlinear wave setting. And the argument goes like this. So in any case, we want to construct solution which stays close to the ground state, but the remainder can be approximated by using the linearization. And as I said, the linearized operator has an eigenfunction, and this plays the main part. And there is, of course, the remainder, which is infinite dimensional. But the point is that since this eigenfunction has negative eigenvalue, the time dynamics is given exponential to some power. And one is exponentially growing, the other is exponentially decaying. So if you want this part remain to be small in time, you need to essentially kill the component which is exponentially growing. And for that purpose, there are essentially two arguments which are both classical. One is so-called Lyapunov-Perron method. That is to construct such solution directly by using fixed point argument on the entire time. And for that purpose, because lambda plus is growing, you need to impose the condition, the boundary condition at time infinity. And if you go from time infinity to time zero, then lambda plus is decaying, right? Because it's e to kt. And for lambda minus, it is like e to minus kt. So it's better to start from time zero and go to infinity. Then it is also decaying. Then, of course, because you are imposing conditions at two different times, this is no longer the Cauchy problem, but still you can solve this by a direct method by the fixed point argument. However, in this argument, you need to control also gamma, so you need some time decay on gamma. That is the scattering theory for the linearized operator around this guy. So here we need some spectral information of the linearized operator. So this is also a demanding argument. But it also tells us if once we construct a solution, then this part has to decay in time. But there is also another method which is called ADAMAR, or in our setting, it is almost like a shooting method, which is kind of soft. Then the argument is like this. It's somehow similar to what I said about the numerics of the shooting method. That is as follows. If this growing mode is initially bigger than the other component, then this growing component will dominate and essentially growing like exponential. And then this is not the solution we want. However, there are two cases. If this is positive, then it grows to plus infinity. If this is negative, it grows to minus infinity. And so there should be something in between. Then, indeed, we can prove that if the solution is getting away from the ground state, then this is the only possibility, only scenario. And therefore, there must be something which doesn't do like this, because either case is open with respect to that parameter. So there must be something in between. And so just by this simple topological argument, we can find some intermediate value of initial data of the unstable mode, such that the solution stays forever close to the ground state. Then, of course, you need to show the uniqueness of this guy, but it is proved by considering the difference of two solutions. So initially, if the difference of two solutions is big in the unstable mode, then in a similar way, it has to grow, and therefore, at least one of two solutions cannot stay close to the ground state. So in this way, you can also prove the uniqueness. So the good thing is that in this way, we need essentially the energy type estimate, and no decay estimate is needed for the remainder. But it also implies that we don't know the behavior of gamma when we construct the solution. So we can apply either this or this depending on the problem. Then. By using this manifold, we can describe the dynamics which are not exactly on the manifold. And the argument is also somehow indicated by the construction. So in particular, by this ADAMAR method, the hypersurface is written in the coordinate in terms of lambda plus, lambda minus, and gamma. And in particular, it is a graph for lambda plus, for in terms of the other variables. And what we have seen is that if this lambda plus is initially bigger than at time zero, then it has to grow exponentially, and it is getting away from the ground state. And if this value is smaller than this, then it has to also grow to the negative minus infinity, to minus infinity, and then the solution exits the ground state. Then we can also prove that the functional, which was used by Payne-Schrödinger or Koenig-Mellrud, is sign definite when the solution is getting away. And in particular, in this case, the k is negative, which means the solution has to grow up. In this case, the k is positive, and that means solution is scattering. Of course, in general, the center stable manifold tells the dynamics only as long as the solution stays close to the ground state. However, thanks to the one-pass theorem, we know the fate of solution doing this way. So as soon as the solution is exiting the neighborhood, we know that it cannot come back to the neighborhood, and it has a fixed behavior, either scattering or the blow up. Therefore, we don't need to trace their trajectory after they exit the neighborhood. We already know their fate. So that's why I can say here it is blowing up or scattering. And then just for the negative time dynamics, you just need to change lambda plus and lambda minus. Then you get the graph for the center unstable manifold. Then the intersection of them is transverse because this is a small order functions. And then by using that, because it is transverse, you have 9 non-empty sets given by the intersection and 4 divided open sets. And it's simply described by the sign of the difference of these two, or the sign of the same thing, but lambda minus and lambda plus are switched. So in this way, you can construct 9 non-empty sets. Okay, I just briefly tell you some idea in the higher energy case. So construction of the center stable manifold for higher energy is not so much different. So we just use the Lyapunov-Perron method for lambda plus and gamma from time infinity. And for the component of lambda minus, this is decaying, we specify it by the parameter A. And here, A is considered on this curve. Since the lambda minus component is exponentially decaying, it may be big at time zero, but it is always going in this way or in this way. Therefore, if I draw this curve, the solution always cross this curve at only once. And we can label each solution by the value of intersection. And so in this way, we can parameterize all solutions by this real number A. And then we need to consider the dynamics going to the negative time. So if A is big, so A is big means we start around from very large time. And if A is big and positive, then the lambda minus component will grow into the negative time and exit in this way. And if it is put negative, then it will exit in this way. And the other component remains small. So if it goes this way, then we know it is blowing up and the other component doesn't matter. And if it goes in this way, we know that it is scattering. And this problem may be more difficult because scattering is a global property. However, if it is scattering this way, then the scattering of the main component will essentially destroy this component. And the energy of this will be sent to the spatial infinity. And also, there is still the remainder gamma, and gamma has big energy. So it's possible that gamma is very well dispersed, but maybe regather as time goes to minus infinity. However, when gamma can concentrate at some time, the other part is already dispersed because it's scattering this way, and they do not interact. So in this way, we can control under this condition. And finally, the heteroscattering solution is obtained by a similar idea to the construction of center stable manifold. Here, we take as an approximate solution the sum of two heteroscattering solutions. One solution is going from minus Q to zero, the other is going from zero to Q. And if you superpose them well separated in time, then they do not interact so much. However, of course, both solutions are unstable, so you cannot freely perturb them. However, if you impose one condition to guarantee to eliminate the growth here and also for here, and if you satisfy these two conditions simultaneously, then perturbation is possible and you get a true solution which looks like this. Okay, so there are many things which we can ask, and actually the main question would be what we can do next. So you can ask many difficult questions, but the question is what we can do, and it's not clear for me. But here I'm trying to ask some question which may be accessible. So the first question may be about this heteroscattering solution. What is the energy of such solutions? Is there any minimal such heteroscattering orbit? So what we can prove is that this phenomena cannot happen in the first region. So this is by Wampach theorem. And by our construction, we can show that this infimum is at least approaching twice of the ground state. And twice of ground state has many meaning. And for example, there are other objects which are not included in our analysis. So first one is higher energy stationary solution, excited states. Or there is also a superposition of two solitons which are getting away from each other. These guys have energy more than twice of the ground state. So then a natural question is that maybe this heteroscattering solution is the first event above our first classification. Is it the first solution where this nine set classification is violated? So we don't know. There may be something else which we haven't seen. And another question is, if this energy is exactly twice of the ground state, it may be less than that. And actually, by using the poor numerics I showed at the beginning, it seems that it is quite less than 2. And it looks like 1.3 something, but it's not clear. And of course, it's very difficult to prove this kind of, even to show the strict inequality, I haven't succeeded. And then if you can go from minus Q to Q, you can actually repeat this kind of thing, because you just destroy minus Q and then create Q, and then you can again destroy this guy and create another solution. You can repeat this finitely many, but then the question is it possible to do for infinitely many times? Then you get a solution which is somehow oscillating between two stationary solutions. Is it possible to have such a solution? This is very looks like unlikely, but even to disprove this is not easy. Then I should mention that for the critical wave equation in the radial asymmetry and three-dimensional case, there is a very great work by Dwickert, Koenig, Merrill. They somehow completely classify asymptotic behavior of solutions. And using their result, we can preclude such a solution. But for the other setting or equation, we don't even know if this can exist. And other question concerning the threshold is that if the threshold manifold, or more precisely the boundary of the scattering solutions and the boundary of the blow-up solutions, the intermediate solution is covered completely by this kind of manifold. Of course, we need to consider also excited states for higher energy, but can we exhaust completely the boundary by constructing such manifold? That looks reasonable, but we cannot even prove this. Of course, there can be many other questions, but it seems very difficult to find the next reasonable question. So that would be the main open question. Okay, so now I want to stop here. Thank you for your attention.